Now we see here that the heat diffusion equation is a linear differential equation with constant coefficients, and it's homogeneous. And we know that we can get at the solution by calculating the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the matrix L. This is the eigenvalue equation, so matrix times vector equals scalar times vector. The vectors, if they fulfill this equation, are called eigenvectors, and the scalar is called the eigenvalue. What's so special about eigenvectors and eigenvalues is, as you see from this equation, multiplying the eigenvector with a matrix corresponds to simply scaling the eigenvector with some eigenvalue. So in contrast, what normally happens to a vector if you multiply it with a matrix, namely that it rotates and gets scaled, eigenvectors only get scaled, they do not get rotated. And that's so special about them and makes them very convenient in many cases. Since the matrix has some zero along the rows and as well as along the columns, we know already, or we can see from that already, that one eigenvector is the one where all the coefficients have the value of 1 with an eigenvalue of 0. So if you take a vector with all 1s in it and you multiply it with a matrix, you essentially simply sum over the elements of a row, and since we know this is 0, this corresponds to 0 times the same vector. Since matrix L is symmetric and real, we know that the eigenvectors as well as the eigenvalues are real. The set of eigenvectors is complete and they are orthogonal to each other. It's not always given that a matrix has a full set of eigenvectors, but symmetric matrices have. So now if we have a set of eigenvectors and eigenvalues, we can write the solution of the differential equation in this way. So we see that H is a superposition of exponentials, so exponential of minus gamma alpha times t times the eigenvector. So normally you would expect to be a plus here if you write this in standard notation. So standard notation would be without this minus, but since we have a minus here, we also need to put a minus down here in the solution. Okay, so this exponential of minus gamma alpha t y alpha, so that's one of the solutions that we get if we have an eigenvector and eigenvalue, and they simply get weighted with these omega alphas with arbitrary weighting factors. Since it's a linear differential equation, you have the superposition principle, so since this is a solution, any linear combination of these solutions is also a solution, and that's the general solution of this system. Now, because of the structure of the Laplace matrix, the eigenvalues are not only real, they're even positive or non-negative. I mean, we have one zero eigenvalue at least, right, for the first eigenvector, but usually, if it's a connected graph, the next eigenvalues will be positive. A positive eigenvalue means that the solutions decay over time. So in the end, if you wait long enough, all the solutions decay except for the one with gamma equals zero. That just stays put. And that means, intuitively, that in the long run, all the nodes have same temperature, 1, because our eigenvector with eigenvalue 0 is the 1 vector. If the graph is disconnected, then you may have other eigenvectors with also an eigenvalue of 0, and these eigenvectors would then have the following form, so they would like, so a second eigenvector could be something like minus 1, minus 1, 1, 1, for example, if you have 4 dimensions with an eigenvalue again of 0. So this is for disconnected graph. Now what we are interested in is how the distribution looks if you wait very long, but not so long that there's no temperature differences at all. And that means if we have a connected graph where we have only one eigenvalue of 0, and that's actually a boring solution, the 1-1-1-1-1 solution. But if we have a connected graph, then the second eigenvector actually is of interest to us, because that survives longest. That's the eigenvector with sort of the smallest eigenvalue, which is not 0. If you want to do an embedding that is more than one-dimensional, we take the third eigenvector. And that, we don't have a very good intuition for that. I mean, that's some mode that you will usually not see by itself. So the heat diffusion analogy doesn't help so much with that regard. But sort of an analogy to the first one, you can take, or to the second eigenvector, because the first one is a 1-1-1-1-1 eigenvector. So the second one is that is of greatest interest to you, but you can also take the third and the fourth one if you're interested in an embedding in higher dimensions. And if the graph is disconnected, you have solutions like I've shown above. Like this one. And this is now useful for clustering, right? So you would group these two into one cluster and these two in one cluster. And that is shown here. This is for the example that I've shown above. So for this example, the first eigenvector will be 1 on all nodes. The second eigenvector would have identical values for these four nodes and different identical values for these two nodes. Yeah, that gives rise to this one here. And that also has an eigenvalue of 0, so that's peculiar in some sense. Okay, so the intuition of the heat diffusion analogy is that you take your graph, the edges represent tubes along which heat can diffuse. If two nodes are very similar, you have a lot of heat going back and forth between the nodes. If they're dissimilar or disconnected, then very little or no heat diffuses back and forth. And if you randomly initialize the whole graph with temperatures, the temperatures will balance out, equilibrate, until in the end you have a heat distribution that is sort of high on one end and low on the other hand. And you can calculate this by solving for the eigenvectors of the Laplace matrix.